Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Great, that was better the second time around. Everyone is family here, I see. Everyone's talking to one another. So we love that everyone feels comfortable here at the New Jersey Performing Arts Center. First, I want to just say welcome. Welcome to NJPAC. I know this isn't any of you's first time being here. So we ask that you just continue to make this your home. We see you here several times a year. So we're excited about that. My name is Nigea Bailey, and I am the associate producer for the community engagement department. As I was explaining to Tim a little earlier, he knows that we're busy, but he wasn't sure how busy we were. And I told him we produce about 200 events a year, just our department alone. We produce 200 events free for the community. Events like this, we partner with organizations like Newark History Society. And then we have some institutional events where we just open up the doors and welcome everyone to come in for free. So we are the access point for the Arts Center, and we take great pride in the many events that we offer. Just want to share with you a couple of things that are coming up. These are just some announcements. We have every third Thursday, who goes to our jazz jams at Clemens Place? Anybody here have been? Yes, we have some fans. So every third Thursday, grab a palm card before you leave out here today. Every third Thursday, right down at 15 Washington Street, we come out and we get our jam on, okay? And it's free, it's open. It's really a hot ticket too. Usually sometimes if you RSVP, you have to RSVP, it's free, but there's usually a waiting list, and so they do two sets. So people are waiting outside. So I'm telling you, it's a happening thing to be at, and some of our young people, older folks, we have every generation is represented. It's a very, very diverse crowd, so we encourage you to come out to that. We also have upcoming, this is our second annual Author Expo Week, and I know we have some writers and some authors in the room, and we have some free resources available for self-published authors. Audible will be here teaching us how to do some audiobooks, so they're going to do a workshop. Mickey Taylor will be with us on that Friday. That's October 11th and 12th. It's going to be a fabulous time, and we're going to be right here in this room in the Chase Room. So come on back, invite your family to the Author Expo. And then we also have, as you may know, our annual Kwanzaa Festival and Marketplace. The Kwanzaa Festival and Marketplace will take place December 20th and 21st. And again, it's free and open to the community. Last year, we had 1,100 kids in this building. We took over the entire art center, and we have fun. We dance. We do face painting. We arm knitting. You name it, we're doing it here in celebration of Kwanzaa. So we invite you to come on out. And without further ado, I just want to welcome Tim Christ of the Newark History Society to come forward. Can we just give him a hand clap as he comes up?
Thanks, Nigea. We are so grateful to you and to John Schreiber and your colleagues at NJPAC for hosting us three times during the course of our program year. Some of you have been with us from the very beginning of the Newark History Society 17 or 18 years ago, and know that we're an all-volunteer group, but we have put on maybe 80, 85 programs since 2002, exploring different aspects of Newark's history, and haven't come even close to running out of topics, and it is great to see all of you here tonight. I did put on about every third chair the list of programs for this year. At the end of October, back here at NJPAC, we're going to have two presenters, one on the polio epidemic of 1916 and the other on the influenza epidemic of 1918. Perhaps it was a terrible time in Newark with those pandemics, and I know that there's some people here whose relatives died during the influenza epidemic, and it seems all the more relevant given the outbreaks of measles that we've experienced, and worth recalling just how important a public health crisis that was 100 years ago. Then next March, we are going to have a program at the library about the women's suffrage movement in Newark with a focus on African-American women suffragists. And George Robb, who is somewhere here, there's George, and Noel Lorraine Williams are going to take the lead on that. And George is actually going to, I think you're going to talk, George, about those who tried to work against women's suffrage. So it's going to be interesting to consider that side of the story as well. Following that, Gail Malmgreen, who is not here tonight, but who has done so much good work with the Newark Archives Project over the years, is going to give us an update. She's been spending a lot of time with the archives in Washington, finding so much material about Newark, and that's going to be the focus of our program then. And we're going to finish in the very beginning of June, back here, with Guy Sterling and Gordon Bond on Guts and Borglum's Seated Lincoln and Wars of America. So that should be a good way to end the year. We are an all-volunteer organization, as I say. We depend on dues. I put some cards here. If you haven't joined already, or if you want to be on our mailing list, please do that. But tonight we have Kathy Kauhl of the Essex County Park System. She has been responsible for the archives there for the last 17 years and has done wonders bringing them to light and sharing them with the public. She was an undergraduate at Penn State, got her master's degrees at both Fairleigh Dickinson and at Rutgers. And we are delighted that she suggested this program and is here tonight to tell us about the early days. Kathy's going to go through her presentation, and then we're going to have handheld mics for Wilbur McNeil to make a few comments about current friends groups for Wequake Park, and then Barbara Bell Coleman about Branchbrook Park, and Nancy Zack about Riverbank Park and efforts in the Ironbound. Following that, we'll have Q&A. And then we're going to end with Kathy again with just a few minutes. And Don Wiss provided some, believe it or not, video, some movies of Branchbrook Park, movie footage of Branchbrook Park in the 1920s. And so that's going to be a bit of the final few minutes of the program. But Kathy, let's start with you.
Thank you, Tim, and good evening. I'm glad to be with you here tonight to tell you about the beginnings of the first county park system in the country, Essex County Parks, and the system of which we're so proud of today. Is this good? Yeah. So Essex County itself is preparing to celebrate this I'll get the hang of this. We're getting ready to celebrate our 125th anniversary next April. However, as historians, you know that history is so much richer and more detailed than a specific date. And so we in the Parks Archives have already been commemorating this anniversary this year, and in a few minutes, you will understand why. So the story begins at least as far back as 1867, when there were efforts by prominent Newarkers that resulted in state legislation to form a park commission to select grounds for parks in the city of Newark. The 26-member Newark Park Commission appears to have settled on just a single location in the northern part of the city, a location that included the Aqueduct Board's reservoir near Clifton Avenue, and that's what's in the southern division of Branchbrook Park that we know today. The Newark board invited Frederick Law Olmsted, who had already developed a fine reputation designing New York City parks with Calvert Vaux, to put his stamp of approval on the site. And the commission received his report in October of 1867. You can see here the letter stating that, and they included it back in their report to the legislature. Now, in his report, Olmsted repeatedly states how short his visit to Newark was. And he suggested that under further study, his ideas might change. So you can see his concept here. His diagram was drawn as typical up to that time, with the Passaic River at the bottom. And he assigned letters to the four tracks in order of their desirability as parkland. Now, I tilted it so that I could do an overlay on a current north at the top map. And I must admit that I created this for a group outside of Newark. Originally, so you'll notice that I cut out a lot of Newark, but so you can see where we are here. We have the Passaic River on the right-hand side here. The top of this section is Belleville Avenue in Belleville. I have Garden State Parkway here, and then Route 280. I did include a little bit down here on Broadway, so that you can see similar to his map. So plot A was including Boiling Spring, which was, I believe, at around 2nd Avenue and 13th Street. And this was ground that was water-soaked and unproductive, and its appearance was unattractive. But nonetheless, this was the most desirous plot for economically establishing land, which he would be able to make interesting with a pastoral character. Plot B was an approach to plot A from the central parts of the city and providing access up the ravine from Broad Street through the quarry area and to the pond beyond the reservoir. And keep in mind the round reservoir that we're familiar with wasn't built until 1871. But this B would include the highland with the fine views that has since become Concourse Hill. Then plot C, Olmsted wanted to include this flat ground beyond the Morris Canal. And the Morris Canal, as you're aware, is the western border of Branchburg Park. He wanted to include this so that he could save most of A for more interesting view, to save it for a more refined and artistic treatment, and C would be used for a parade and ball ground, so for playing fields. And then D was land between Bloomfield Avenue and 6th Avenue, least desirable of all that we examined to be included in the park, but you'll notice that that's a lot of that is included in our current park. It was also very important that already he was writing about additional strips of land. They aren't in his diagram, but he was talking about 200 to 400 feet wide areas reaching the park from different directions, and suggested that these would be popular with taxpayers wanting to live in an area associated to the park. And the one strip he mentioned, one of them would have included Silver Lake, and I believe that would have been up from this area. And then it would have also included the Second River Ravine area, which later was acquired by the Essex County Park for Branchburg Park extension. But that was in the 1920s then, till that was acquired. Much of the report that Olmsted, much of his report focused on the economics rather than the design of a park. And So the report was presented to the Park Commission, the Newark Park Commission, and also to the legislature, but there were challenges in realizing a major park for the city after that, including multiple attempts to pass legislation to fund the purchase of the parkland. And apparently, to acquire Olmsted's outline, the city was to be bonded for $1 million, according to the Sunday Call later. Also, people in other parts of the city were unwilling to support a single park in the northern reaches. So the Newark Park Commission disbanded in 1871 without having accomplished its goal. So, but the desire for parkland did not disappear. And over the years, there grew a confluence of interest, including a growing park movement around the country and in Newark. In 1889, the Aqueduct Board dedicated the reservoir property for parkland, but they made no improvements to it. Charles H. Pell, who had been involved in this process since 1866, and the Roseville Improvement Association, to which he belonged, published a tract promoting a park and promoting the name Branch Brook over Reservoir Park. Out of the association, there was formed a board, which included Cyrus Peck, who would later be appointed to the Essex County Park Commission. So over a period of several years, Mayor Haynes and the Governor Wirtz also made suggestions about parks. Mayor Haynes suggested that the area around the reservoir there at Branch was in a bad sanitary condition, but could transform into the most attractive spot in Newark. And Governor Wirtz also mentioned parks in his annual address. The Newark Board of Trade created a park committee, and they came out with a report in 1892. And likewise, the Orange Board of Trade was concerned over development creeping up the first Watchung Mountain, and especially quarry operations that were encroaching on natural landscape treasures such as Eagle Rock. And it was at an Orange Board of Trade meeting in December of 1893 that was attended by Newark Board of Trade President William Muir, where discussion of a larger park project really took off. This would be a project not for a larger park, but for a larger system beyond the boundaries of Newark. And so representatives from the two trade organizations met, and Frederick Kelsey was one of the two who were tasked with writing legislation that would create a countywide park system. In my 17 years in looking at this and studying this, I've been amazed at how everything had to go through legislation at that time. So the bill allowed for any county with a population over 200,000 to appoint a temporary commission to formulate a plan for a park system. And just throw out the figures here. So in 1890, the population of Essex County was just over 250,000, and Newark's was about 180,000 of that. 10 years later, so on either side of this time period, the county was up another 100,000 at 360. And Newark was almost at a quarter of a million. So there was a lot of growth during this time. So yes, the joint meeting, they finalized the bill, it was introduced, passed and signed, and Judge Depew appointed a five-person board. It included Cyrus Peck, Frederick Kelsey, Stephen Meeker, Edwin Jackson, and George Bramall. And they were on this unpaid board that met for the first time in June of 1894. And June of 1894, and now you know why it is that the Parks Archives is already full into celebrating this time period. This preliminary commission, as it's come to be known, was given 2 years and a $10,000 allotment to do their work. One of the things they did was collected information from other park systems, and this was very easy because several of their members had been doing this for decades. They even published a tract on the economic benefits realized in increased property tax revenues by cities that had established a park system. They also solicited location ideas from local municipalities, organizations, and individuals, and received delegations from those municipalities at their meetings. And then, needing to sort through these many, many park suggestions, they sought professional advice from landscape architects. The first, they were at first approaching the Olmsted firm with the expressed desire that Frederick Law Olmsted Sr., who had visited back in 1867, be personally involved in the project. The senior Olmsted was not well. He was soon to retire, and the firm was busy with other projects. They were not even able to come to the county for a month or two. And so the board reached out to other park designers. These included Nathan F. Barrett. He had planned Chevy Chase near Washington, D.C., and was co-founder of the American Society of Landscape Architects. Ehrenberg and Webster, I've not been able to find any information about. John Bogart was connected with Prospect Park in Brooklyn, also with Washington Park in Albany, and some Nashville and Chicago Park projects. And then Arthur F. Gray and Frank M. Blaisdell had done many public parks and cemeteries in the Boston area. And so here we have two of the proposals. Bogart and Barrett, actually, they were approached separately, but they actually made their proposal together. They included this and also a map showing the different population centers. And you can see that each of these has, this is South Mountain, what's now South Mountain, so Eagle Rock on up past Kipps. It's interesting how this, you look at this from the eyes of today, we have hilltop land here, land that belonged to the city of Newark at that time in Verona, and there's Verona Lake was included. The Graham Blaisdell included land around Weequake. Bogart and Barrett did not, although just outside of there. This was interesting, a chunk of the meadows. And then along the, so here we have the Southern Division and middle of Branch Brook. Here we have Branch Brook. So these were their ideas for park systems. For the commissioners and the board, this was an opportunity to see, a chance to see all the beauty of their county. And so these are all identified, but I would just comment, Crystal Lake was a resort near Eagle Rock, a resort, and they did attempt to negotiate to get that and failed later on. You have here empty lots down Neck, which became Eastside Independence Park. These are before pictures of that. So looking from Van Buren, looking northwest. The falls at Second River, which by the time land along the Second River was acquired for the parks, this, I believe, had been blasted away. You can see here the quarry near Eagle Rock, which concerned the Orange Board of Trade, that this might be encroaching on those natural wonders, and the site in Orange, I think, eventually became Orange Park. The sister of General Phil Kearney offered the homestead, but had too many strings attached to make that a viable offer. So in addition to these other tasks that they did, the first commissioners worked on some more mundane matters whether a permanent commission should be elected or appointed, what was the best number of commissioners. Luckily, they decided that 26 was not that number, like the Newark Park Commission. They looked at the scope of the authority of the commission, whether to fund the parks through direct assessment or a percentage of the county's total ratables. And so this last task, probably the least exciting of the tasks, but I would suggest that it was highly valuable and important in making a success of the subsequent commission. So the 1894 board completed its work considerably less time and spent less than half the $10,000 available, rather unheard of. When they submitted their report to the legislature in early 1895, they had ready another bill to establish a permanent commission with authority to acquire and maintain in Essex County ample open spaces for the health, pleasure, and profit of its growing population. So again, I have here, can you see the dates on there? They're very faint, but in short order, they had a draft of a bill. They later amended it because they wanted to add, so that there would be no question that the voters wanted this, they added a voter referendum. So the bill was passed unanimously by the state Senate and Assembly. Governor Worth signed it. The voters approved the referendum nearly 2-1. Actually, Newark voters were, there were reasons why they were concerned that some of them were voting against it. So there had been a movement against this, and I think it might have had to do with the details of the bill, but it passed by 2-1 and in the county, and then the preliminary commission finished up their work and turned things over to the first meeting on April 20th of 1895 of the Essex County Park Commission, and that is why the county will be celebrating that as at the anniversary come April. So look for more news about that. We're excited for some plans for that. So the commission powers, I just wanted to say the reason why we celebrate that. So after this point, the commissioners' terms began and ended in April. The annual reports of the Park Commission came out in April. They did an annual tour in April. And so 1895 has always been cited as the establishment date of the Essex County Park Commission, despite the earlier one also being called an Essex County Park Commission. And the commission was given powers to acquire land either by purchase or through condemnation. They were allowed to accept gifts of land. They would maintain the parks. They would locate and construct boulevards, the term for the parkways, and it was all to be paid through bonds handled by the county. At that time, there were only 25 acres of parkland in the county. And they hoped to establish a park system of between 4,000 and 4,500 acres, and they estimated the undertaking would take $2.5 million. They went right to work, as you might be able to see in the minutes over there, setting up committees and establishing bylaws. And it was agreed that of the proposals that they had received for possible park systems and locations, that the plans submitted by John Bogart and Nathan Barrett were the most appropriate for Essex County. And so in May, those men were appointed as landscape architect and engineer. They began acquiring land. The first acreage to be acquired was the land around the reservoir. It was transferred by resolution of the Street and Water Commissioners of the City of Newark on July 18th, 1895. And this would become the bulk of Southern Division of Branchbrook Park. But around it, as you can see by this time, the land had been subdivided and many buildings stood there. So all of this land, except this was still being used as a reservoir, and there was a pumping house here, so that was still used by the water board and commission. But all of this land was donated. But you see here all of these small lots, and most of that was built upon here and here. And so I have these two images. This house here is very faint. It was a McCabe house, very old home on Old Drift Street. Any relation, Tom? And then I don't know where these are, but you can see a lot of this was these kind of 2 and 3 story homes, and it looks like the way they were tearing it down, they were planning to reuse those. But you know, just acquiring land is just the first step, and after that needed to be under drainage, grading, all of those things before buildings and structures and planting can go in. So already in 1895, there were major capital improvements commenced in 4 of the parks, including Branch Brook, which is seen here. Notice the steam shovel and the narrow gauge rail line over in the left-hand side. I think that might be the middle division, but these other two are the southern division. And then here is just a little bit later in the development, the lower, on the left-hand side, this photo is from 1897. You can see that all the buildings have been cleared. You don't yet, so there's the reservoir. This is Clifton Avenue. This land was high land. We have a picture with the buildings before. You can see that this was Bogart and Barrett's way to not have to grade this all and just deal with this difference in land. This building here is the chapel, the temporary chapel beside where the cathedral would be in the future. And we have a photo from just a year later showing fully built Barringer High School, the old Barringer High School, right in this location. Eventually, by 1905, you'd see Park Avenue Bridge here. So the photo at the top is looking to the east. You can see that it's the grading is pretty much completed. And I don't know if you can make out, there's a row of workers here. I don't know whether they're doing planting, but some finishing work there. But on the shore, on this side, is completely unfinished. And then this is probably a year or so later, the paths have been completed, plantings put in, and quite a few very ornamental plantings there in the Bogart and Barrett plan. Meanwhile, the first park to be completed was Eastside Park, now Independence Park, in the Ironbound. And this is a very early picture. There are trees there, but they don't seem to have been leafed out at that moment. So this is Van Buren on the right and Adams on the left, and what street? In front there, looking north. So I don't want to have an argument here, but for those people who say Branch Brook was the first land, and East Side was the first one completed. Now, this was a Bogart and Barrett plan. Several decades later, there would be some changes of renovation done by the Olmsteads. So by the end of 1897, land purchases totaled nearly $2 million, and improvements amounted to nearly $200,000. Bogart and Barrett were advised that their services would be terminated due to insufficient funds, but there was some discontent over their project management and other complaints about their design. So they were replaced by the Olmsted Brothers firm. This was now being run by John C. Olmsted and Frederick Law Jr. For most for the most part, parks that had construction well along, the Southern Division, a Branchbrook Park, obviously East Side Park or Independence was finished. In Orange Park, the plans and some of the work was done so that even though the Olmsteds didn't really like that there was a roadway, a driveway there, they felt the park was too small for that, but they left it because the work was done, or nearly. But the Olmsteds came up with their own designs for parks where the efforts were not as far along. And I show you here two plans for the same park. I had always heard that the Olmsteds preferred the pastoral meadow scenes of the English estate to ordinary or to the orderly East, more European design. So without seeing the names on these, I might have guessed that the Olmsted one was the one on the left. However, as you study the plans, it becomes apparent that the Olmsted's design is so much more complete. It includes structural elements, open spaces, winding paths, expansive cross views, and even active recreation elements, which Bogart and Barrett resisted tremendously. So up here you have a gym, here's a little children's play area. So both landscape architects firms, the Bogart and Barrett, and also the Olmsted brothers, planned a park system for Essex County Park that included four elements. Large city parks, and the examples at that time would have been Central Park and Prospect Park in in Manhattan and Brooklyn. Then neighborhood or local parks, sometimes also called playgrounds, and that term had a much more extensive meaning then than it does today. That included play fields and not just playgrounds with equipment. In fact, there was very little playground equipment at that time, and not companies that were specifically making that or only making that. So these smaller parks in dense communities. And then reservations. This was land outside the more developed areas and set aside or reserved for public use. And then greenways to link the parks. So I want to say something about this map here. This is a map that accompanied the Olmsted Report on Parkways in 1915. And so in 1894-95, the Olmsteds had a report that was telling what they would plan for a park system, but they never did complete a map then, like we saw for the others. This was the only comprehensive plan that the Olmsted firm did for the parks and parkways in the county in 1915, and they knew then that some of it would certainly not be able to be done then. It's interesting to look at it. Today's viewpoint, we have Verona, but you have Hilltop Land, you have Mills Reservation is right there. So a lot of what has been acquired since then is actually on here, and I think a lot of people know that when it was. So it's interesting to see that. Let's get back to the elements of the park system. Large city park features would be meadows, meandering drives, vistas, and larger water elements with some active recreation tucked in here and there. And Branchbrook Park, of course, is in this category, but so too is Wequaic. So Wequaic, as a historic location, it was at Dividend Hill within the park where representatives of Newark and Elizabeth met in 1668 to set the boundary between the two towns. And in the mid-19th century, James J. Mapes, innovative publisher of The Working Farmer, farmed land now part of the park. And in part because of him, the New Jersey State Agricultural Fair was held at Waverly Fairgrounds, just east of the Wequaic Lake, from 1866 until 1899. So this photo, a before picture, and shows orchards, and so it's possible that some of those trees might be one of those hard cider apple trees that we had a program on in the past. So the area was certainly large tract on the southern edge of the city and county, containing a lake, and in 1896 it was designated as a reservation. So at that time, some people questioned the location, saying it was just a mosquito-infested bog and of more use to Union County than to anybody in Essex County. And they also questioned whether Franklin Murphy, who had very much promoted this location, was benefiting financially. He did resign from the Waverly Fairground Board, but he still owned stock. But the park gained popularity as improvements were made. You can see the bogs were removed from the lake, and there was, this was after much conversation about whether to raise the water level and destroy some trees or do the work of getting the bogs out of there. And then they also imported sheep and a shepherd from Dorset. An addition to the park along Elizabeth Avenue provided northwestern access with playground and tennis near the growing neighborhood, Wequake neighborhood. So this is just the addition up here. So here's Elizabeth Avenue, and the Waverly commuter train station was added here. This addition and the use of it prompted a change in status from a reservation to a park in 1909. And I quote from the annual report, "Because its popularity has been so great as to make necessary its immediate development rather than its simple reservation for future improvements." Popularity of golf and the growth of the neighborhood led them to put in the first public golf course in New Jersey in 1914. It was a 9-hole course. And there is opening day. That's Franklin Murphy teeing off. And Arthur Dillon on the right. He was the architect who did many of our the projects for the parks, but he had done the golf house at Wequake. And then Wequake, I think, I would say because of Dividend Hill being right there, this location was used in 1916 for the 250th anniversary pageant, this grand festivities with casts of thousands at this location. Okay, let's go on to the next element is the neighborhood parks. With Newark's population burgeoning, vocal demand grew for smaller parks to provide some breathing space. And Olmsted design elements for local parks had more formality to deter chaos. And they used trees and shrubs or different elevations to screen out the buildings and the streets of the city beyond. And these locations, these parks were too small to have drives through them or roadways. And Riverbank is our example here. This is a densely populated, mixed-use immigrant community. Riverbank, so in 1905, the 5th and 11th Ward pushed for legislation for more parkland in the Ironbound. The two blocks north of Market Street on either side of Chambers Street were chosen. And so this photo at the top, the road, you're looking north to the Passaic River. The road going through there is Chambers Street. You can see that there were some vacant lots here. That's one reason why this was chosen. But there were also tenements here. And then there were two mansions. An older one, the Ward family, home, and then the Baalbach of the Baalbach smelting plant home here. So these two blocks were designed, put into the design of the Olmsteads. They packed a lot of design into this small area, including active recreation space. The picture down here is a temporary playground, and you know, see what you think. Was it demand for play space? I mean, why did they put it there before they even graded and designed the park? Was it demand for play space by all of these immigrant children? And certainly it looks well used, but notice the proximity to Miss Ward's house. So her house is here, this playground's here. I mean, the tenements and so on were over here. Did they put it there so that, to try to urge this recluse cat lady to leave? They didn't want bad publicity by kicking her out. So the Olmsted design, I've mentioned here, but it could not satisfy the demand for open space in the Ironbound. And so subsequently, the park was expanded to the west, two blocks, as you can see in this lower corner. You can see the blocks and then the baseball that was added there. This is opening day of the expanded. The older part is up here. The trees that were there are gone. They were not doing well with all the fumes from the smelting plant and all of these smokestacks. But it looks very open there compared to today. We have pictures there of Westside Park too, but after the first round of parks and those park designs done by the landscape architects, it was then up to locals to get legislation for funding acquisition and development of additional parks. And you can see here most of those were neighborhood parks then, under 35 acres, and we have a list here of the ones that were built and then designed by the Olmsteads. So those of you who are interested in Westside Park, those are my only two images of that, but just soon after it was built. On to the next element, the reservations, land kept in reserve, less obvious design, but still a carefully studied aesthetic forestry. Part of the mountain park idea from the South Mountain was part of the mountain park idea from the very beginning. It was originally to extend Eagle Rock on down and then only south to South Orange Avenue. George Brommel influenced the commission to go south of South Orange Avenue and include Washington Rock, Hemlock Falls, a lot of the features that we know of South Mountain today. And then a crest drive was to extend between the reservations, mountain reservations, and beyond, so that the journey to and from the reservation and enjoyment of the large natural space was expected to fill one's day with fresh air and healthy relaxation. So I don't expect you to read this, but I just wanted to I'm including this so that you get some idea of the sheer undertaking of acquiring this land. Now, the map itself is half again as large. So the match line is South Orange Avenue here, and here's South Orange Avenue. So this is extra. But I didn't want to overlay that because of all of this, and this is really what I want you to see, this listing of all of the different lots that had to be acquired. And some of these had been in families for a long time, so even finding out and then coming up with a values for this land when it hadn't, there hadn't been much turnover here, was a complicated business. So this listing included the lot number, the previous property owner, the acreage, the cost, the date it was acquired, and whether if by sale or by condemnation. So if someone was not wanting to sell, then it would go to a condemnation board to determine a fair price. So this was a place in south along the mountain, maintaining a wild character where people could escape their urban environment for a day. And John Olmsted spelled out the Olmsted's design philosophy for reservations in his report for on the improvement of South Mountain Reservation, quoted here. So this lower picture is Brookside Drive with the vista. And then we have the west branch of the Rahway River. Now, the old growth forest had been harvested for industry along here, and many landowners kept a woodlot. So what you found, to a large extent, were homogeneous stands of secondary growth trees. But despite nearly three centuries of contact and use of the land, the Olmsteds had a vision that would nurture its natural loveliness and beauty. So this, the picture on the left, I believe is from Mayapple Hill looking southeast across the Orange Reservoir. And so this area right in here would be where the Turtleback Zoo is today. And we have one more element then of the park system, the parkways. Greenways for pleasure rides from one park to another. Olmsted and Vox are credited with coining the term and creating the first Eastern Parkway in Brooklyn. It was expected that the parkways, like the parks, would increase the real estate values along their length. And because they were quite a length through built-up areas, they were naturally the most expensive and complicated to acquire. So I showed you how complicated South Mountain was, but the parkways were. And so they were not open to commercial vehicles since they were for pleasure. And I wanted to add one more to the top, that these were planned to be planned and acquired simultaneously with the parks. But sometimes those complications cause delays. So the example I'm using here is East Orange Parkway. It was the first, one of the first being planned. There were compromises in that. As you can see in the diagram of Bogart and Barrett plan, it was initially planned to have separate ways for pleasure vehicles, for pedestrians, for bicycles, for equestrians, and for service vehicles. But you can't get that in like 6,800 feet. I think this one, it was a little wider at the time. But so this was just one of the compromises. By 1899, already they had eliminated the idea of separate service roads and bike paths. But service vehicles and commercial vehicles were not allowed on these roads. These setbacks and compromises did make it difficult to create a true system of parks and parkways as was initially desired. So this first section was underway in 1899. And subsequent additions took East Orange Parkway beyond the borders of East Orange, and it was renamed the Oraton Parkway, and then it was sold to the state in 1952 for the Garden State Parkway. So here we have a before and after picture. This is from Main Street in East Orange looking north. You can see here's a railroad bridge. This railroad bridge is still there today, but you cannot see it looking north. You can only see it from the north looking south because 280 is raised and going right through there. And the Garden State Parkway is crossing right about that same spot. And then this is the same section of the parkway from that railroad bridge looking north towards New Street. And this is the same section that was in the plan, a Bogart and Barrett plan earlier, two slides before. So none of these parkways that the commission established exist today as greenways between our parks. Besides the East Orange Parkway, which I said was sold for the Garden State Parkway in 1952, there was Prospect Avenue. This went from Eagle Rock towards South Mountain Reservation, was to be part of that Crest Drive. It never was developed. It was owned as part of the park system, but never developed, and was turned over to the county in 1923. Park Avenue from Branchbrook Park west to Llewellyn Park. The Newark section of this, because of increased traffic, was turned over to Newark in 1931 and the other areas in subsequent years. And then the Passaic River Parkway, which was developed along the Passaic and Belleville and to Nutley, it included playground, shelter, tennis courts. We have plans for this, but I've never seen photos. We have this photo here that's before it was built of that area, but if anybody knows anybody who has any photos of any of that playground, tennis, shelter, even the roadway of the Passaic River Parkway, I'd be very interested. So you have the kind of equipment that would build these roads, like Park Avenue, and then Park Avenue, as you can see, it really didn't have space to be a true parkway, was more of a boulevard. And then I mentioned along the Passaic looking to the shoreline where the parkway was. Okay, so when the Essex County Park System observed its 50th anniversary in 1945, it was at 4,204 acres. It hit that goal right on, right? From what they had thought that they would have. There were 12 miles of parkway. By this time, they no longer had Park Avenue or Prospect. It had cost over $15 million for all the land and capital improvements versus the $2.5 million that they had planned. But there was World War I in there, there was World War II, there was the Depression, and also land values, I think, had increased so that this wasn't seen as a problem. And they had set a precedent with benefits of a county-wide park system that was provided proof that this could work and be a great thing. So now, as we approach and celebrate our 125th anniversary, we have 6,076 acres of parkland. We have 24 parks, 5 reservations, 3 golf courses, South Mountain Recreation Complex, which includes Turtleback Zoo, and other facilities there, and then we have other recreational facilities as well. And I'm skipping that one. We have partnerships, really beneficial partnerships, with lots of conservancy groups, and I think we will be hearing from some of those in a moment. And whoops, let me go back, and then get back to Newark. So what of Newark? I think the Essex County Park System has proven to be a solution to Newark's quest for parkland, and a large portion of the parkland in the city of Newark is part of the Essex County Park System, accounting for 758 acres and 9 parks. So that's Branchbrook, Veterans Memorial, Riverbank, Riverfront, Independence, Wequake, Westside, Balesburg, and Ivy Hill. So, end.
pass the microphone back.
First of all, I'm no longer the voice of Whipway Park. The new president is Isaiah Little, and our director is Ms. Hines. I always hate to get in these discussions about Park and Newark because I had the early experience of being invited over to New York City Central Park and spent the day with Elizabeth Ballas Rogers, who gave us her entire staff for a whole day and how to develop our park. And she said, Newark being the third oldest city in the nation, being like New York, Boston, and then Newark, they have to take advantage of their historical sites, and they're not doing it. And she gave us the partnership agreement, which they had with New York City. And that's what we'd use. We use Central Park's conservancy and develop it. And after a long struggle, we made that possible. But when you talk about history, that's what it is, his history. And I recommend that everyone should get a chance to read the New York Times 1619 report, the magazine section. And you will find the same symptoms of what we have when you talk about parks. You know, you can call it a park. And I always had a joke with the county exec, Joseph DiVincenzo, about the first park. And I say, it depends on what you call it. I mean, if you call Waverly Fairgrounds, you know, if it has all activity, then it's a park. If you call it Lions Farm, and they have all the activities that a park has, it's a park. You know, it depends on who's naming it. I've went through thousands of pages of history on Newark and Newark and its parks, and through all those pages, I couldn't find 19 pages on African Americans and Native Americans in this city. And when you want to talk about the history of Newark and you want to talk about the parks, I had a chance to be on the board with the Olmsted group, and they permitted me to travel all over the country. And you really saw fine parks throughout this here nation built by Frederick Law Olmsted. And I developed a love for Frederick Law Olmsted like I developed a love for Franklin Murphy, whose statue is in Whitway Park in Decay. And if you start talking about revitalizing our city, it has to start with the statue of Franklin Murphy and Dividend Hill. You know, I always joke when we started out in the park, a group of runners, we was on Dividend Hills, and they read the monument that a teacher from Southside High School then, you know, with Shabazz High School now, it starts out with long before the white man, the Native Americans used that as their grounds. And it's a nice plaque. Somebody took it and stole it. But, you know, that's... When you go around and you read and you go over the country and you see parks, you'll know that in Newark that has 7 Olmsted parks. I like Frederick Olmsted because he fought in the Civil War, went in there at 17 and came out a lieutenant, came back, and he was a businessman. He made money, but his house on Broad Street, on South Broad Street, is in Decay, a historical site. His statue in Dividend Hill, which is a monument to the founding of Newark. And he's, Franklin Murphy was the one who developed our water system and was instrumental in getting the land up in Pequannock, you know. So, you know, I don't want to take up the time, but I have a package for the moderator that some of the things that the historians, that some of the things that Whitway Park did with very little money. And to me, as a kid growing up, Whitway Park was going to the shore, was going up to Martha's Vineyard. That was our entertainment. So when you start talking about parks, you know, that was more than a park for us when we went out on 4th of July and saw the fireworks and saw the horse racing. But when it was Waverly Fairgrounds, they had more activity than the county established, and they had people jumping from high towers and things like that, horse races, bike races, human races. They had all those things. So to distinguish between a fairground, a farm that had some of those activities is ridiculous. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Barbara Bell Coleman from the Branch Brook Park Alliance, and anybody that works in Branch Brook Park has to first give recognition to Liz Del Tufo, because she's been the mother and the grand dame, the caretaker of that park for many, many years. I didn't know that some of my other colleagues would be here. Mary Sue Sweeney Price, one of our trustees, and one of the people that I really do consider a partner, not a volunteer, but Casey Goger, has been volunteering in Branch Brook Park as a master gardener. And her husband, Bob, and I, who worked together 30 years ago, gets dragged to the park whether he wants to or not whenever we're shorthanded. So I am so grateful to all of you. And I didn't know that any of them were coming tonight. They didn't know I was coming tonight, but it just shows that they're here because they're interested. They're here because they care on their own. And so I thank you all for being here tonight. Three major points. When we started in 1999, Wilbur probably doesn't even know this, but we were inspired to start a conservancy because of the work that was being done and had been done in Wequoyoc Park. And so I always say all credit goes to the extraordinary organization that you and others had put together there and led the way in so many ways and areas that you continue to be a light and a role model to all of us, and we look forward to working with the new leadership that's there. Second, when we did start, we had a singular goal, and that was to undertake the first comprehensive restoration of Branch Brook Park in 100 years. There was a beginning, a middle, and an end. We thought that if we could raise the money to restore the park, which had really suffered from benign neglect for many, many years, that we would be done. We would declare victory. We're not going to be evergreen. I think that was one of the reasons Prudential was such a big funder with us, because we promised to go away after we finished that one task. They said they didn't need one more community-based organization, so we promised to go away. Well, we formed a public-private partnership with the County of Essex, and we undertook a cultural landscape report. It came back with a price tag of $100,000 if we were to do $100 million, if we were to do every single thing that needed to be done in Branch Brook Park. So my late co-chair, Pat Ryan, without any discussion, said, we'll do half. So $50 million, that is how our goal got established. Again, started in 1999, declared victory in 2014, and I was happy that that day came. I cried so much of tears of joy that we were finished, because that was the hardest money that I thought that I ever had to raise, despite the enormous help that we had gotten from so many people. But I was done. The county wasn't too happy, Dan Savanti, the director in particular, and he wasn't so happy throughout the whole process. He said, you're killing me. It looks great, but how are we going to maintain it? I said, you'll handle that like I handled this. So again, we thought we were done. 2014, 2015, Casey and a few master gardeners continued working in the park. It was lonely. The park began to look worse and worse. All the work that we had done quickly was going back to seed. So we reconvened in 2017. And so I really appreciate Casey, because it was mighty lonely. We were just experimenting all over the place, and it was like a finger in the dike. So in 2017, we reconvened and we said, let's try a pilot demonstration project for the next 3 years and really try to figure out how we can do, what kind of model could we create that was cost effective and efficient, that utilized volunteers. We expanded our partnerships to include the Community Foundation of New Jersey and Jersey Cares, who really is the premier recruiter of volunteers. Over the next 3 years, we have brought 4,000 volunteers to Branchville Park. We also said to the county, look at, we're 360 acres, but we're gonna just take 85 of those acres and really try to develop this cost-effective, cost-efficient model. We have done that, and in June we announced that we were going to institutionalize the Care of the Park program starting in 2020. We feel that we have great capacity now that we've increased our partnerships. Over the last 3 years, we brought in over 4,000 volunteers on a monthly basis. In 2020, we will be bringing volunteers into the park to work with our lonely 3 or 4 member staff. Stand up, Alexis, because that's why she's in shorts, because she came right from the gardens to here tonight to hear this. But we do feel like we're, you know, and every, it wouldn't be worth doing if it wasn't something we could share with everyone in the city of Newark, everyone within the county, because it's not just Branch Brook or Weequick. If New York City Central Park couldn't do it without volunteers, we certainly can't do it without volunteers and a lot of other support. So my last two things. We're always recruiting volunteers, and so if anyone here is interested, come to the park and volunteer, and I think it will give you a new sense of things. Last but not least, once again, inspired by the work that was done at Weequick Park, and in following in their footsteps, in partnership with the county, in 2020, we will co-sponsor with the county the National Association of Olmsted Parks annual meeting and symposium in Newark. It will be on April 23rd, 24th, and 25th. The symposium annually is attended also by the Association of Landscape Architects from all over the country. And the public will also be invited to attend. And NAOP says that they are very, very excited about returning to Newark to see the great work that has been done throughout the county. I'm just hopeful that all of you will consider joining with us and consider volunteering with us. And I hope that we can spread our model to other parks throughout the county and the city of Newark.
Barbara. And now Nancy Zach about efforts in the Ironbound, and then we'll open it up to Q&A for Kathy and Wilbur and Barbara and Nancy.
Good evening, everybody. I think we got the idea from Wilbur too, and the inspiration and the idea of the Green Acres funding. Wasn't that something that came from Wilbur, that we could somehow use some of that money to help our parks, and that became something that park groups could do. And we had more of an unusual group, because we almost lost our park, and what created our park group and our community sense of the value of the park was the fact that highlighted by the fact that we almost lost our park in 1996. It was going to become a minor league baseball stadium for what was that guy's name? Rick Cerrone, yeah. Anyhow, My husband said, you know, you'll never win that because there were so many people lined up on the side of taking that park. Ironbound has 50 to 60,000 residents growing all the time. We had two little parks, 10 acres each, roughly. We had Independence Park and Riverbank Park. That's it for green space. There was no place else people could go. So, you know, it was one of those things where you really wanted to fight to hang on. And it was a five-year battle. It went, there were a series of strategies, which I will not go into here, but included a legal challenge, a public referendum, and then a historic preservation piece. And we knew nothing about the history of the park. When we started, we were looking for a place for my daughter Beth to play. And we, you know, we learned so much from the Preservation and Landmarks Commission and other, and Yolana Zakalak did our application to the state, which was not approved until after we won the fight. It went in a very unusual, usually it goes state approval to federal. Ours went federal down to state. and the winning strategy was the Parks Department, the Green Acres has regulations. When you take away a park, you have to give back equivalent acreage. The equivalent acreage which the county was planning to give back was along the river, down by down in the east part along Raymond Boulevard there. And so after we won the fight, Essex County said to us, okay, you will get your remediated riverbank park, we will keep it as it is, and we're going to give you that riverfront park. But all the way through that, there were lots of mobilizing going on. Senior citizens folded 5,000 green and blue ribbons that everybody was wearing, green for the trees along the river. We were pushing that riverfront plan for a couple of decades. So when the moment came, we were ready. And we jumped on it, but we, you know, certainly appreciated the fact that the county was ready too, so it worked out. And I'm going to let my colleague say a word or two about what's going on now. This is my colleague and right-hand man, Lenny Thomas.
Good evening.
And please notice his T-shirt. He has the first Riverbank Park T-shirt, and if you can't see it, it says where history lives. And the 2001 date is the reopening of the park after we won that fight.
Thank you. This is the reason I'm here, because I had the T-shirt. Otherwise, I'd be someplace else. First of all, good evening. Kathy, I want to thank you, too. You solved the mystery of why that statue of Franklin Murphy is in Weequake Park. Wilbur, we're coming for it, all right? We're coming for it. Just want to let you know. It's interesting, being one of the smallest parks in the whole system, it makes you sort of unique. It makes you feel like the kid of the whole system a lot of times. People talk about places like Weequake and Branchbrook Park, and they're like tremendous. We're like 2% of what they have. So it's amazing. But yet, with all that, we are one of the busiest parks with people per square foot throughout the system. The first year that our park opened, we had like 10,000 people. And you're talking back in 1907. 10,000 people the first year. Wow. And the park wasn't even finished then. It was only half completed. Our park sees a lot of people who are immigrants. And when we talk about immigrants, we're talking about immigrants from other countries. We talk about African Americans came from the South. They all came to the Ironbound because there were jobs there. They came there, they were looking for a better life for their families. And One of the people that we just talked about, Franklin Murphy, saw that there was a need for something else for the people to have there. Many people worked in factories like his own factory. And Franklin was supposed to be a good employer. He gave his people a good wage, but he was looking for something else. Most of the people that worked there worked in a factory that was dark and smoky. They had come from a land where they worked outside, it was sunny, there was fresh air, and it was a whole different paradigm coming here. When they went home, they went to a tenement that was dark. So in his talking to his work, he said, we need something else. Money wasn't it, and he was right, it wasn't it. And he thought about having park space, and he belonged to a group of guys that were called the Good Citizens League, and they were like the precursors of the Fresh Air Fund and programs like that. And they thought that by getting people back to nature, they'd become better. And you know what? He was right. Every day when I go to the park, I see people who come through the entrance and change. They're like here in the street, like this. And when they come inside, they're like lifted. It's amazing. I go to the playground, spend a lot of time there talking to parents, talking to kids. And I see kids that don't even speak the same language. They look way different from one another. They play together all day long. Can we do that someplace else? I one story I love. I saw a little boy riding a bicycle all day. Like he was going there for like 3 hours. I was in and out of around the playground. I said, wow, he really shouldn't be in the playground. But I'm not going to say he's not running over anybody, so that's a good thing. Well, next thing this woman said, it's time to go home. Some other little boy goes over to him and takes the bicycle. I said, wait a minute, what's this? It turns out the bike belonged to the second little boy. He didn't want the bike. He wanted to go on the slides and play with the other people. So he let this other guy play with his bike all day long. When it was time to go home, he got the bike back. No argument. Got a thank you. He went home with his bike. So the other guy went back and did something else. It just showed me how well kids play together. And that's one of the things we have the park for. People go there that don't know each other. They talk. They interact. Sometimes they don't. Some just sit by the tree. Some lay in a tree, go to sleep. I can't do that, but hey, they do that. Some run, not for me. Some walk, hey, there you go. And some just sit there and watch. And it's such a great experience. It's almost like magic. I tell people, you go inside a park, especially in Olmsted Park, and it's like you're separated from the rest of the world. You know you're still in the city, all right? We're not crazy. But it's different. You don't hear the trucks. You don't hear the car. You don't hear that city as much. You look over the bushes and trees. You can see the tops of the buildings, but you feel like you're in a different place. And that's what I use as my hook to invite people to come there. Come to the park. Check it out. You'll like it. Of course, when you come, I'm looking for you. I'm looking for you because we need the volunteers, as Barbara said. It's the lifeblood. If we don't, it dies out. Without the new people in the community and making that connection, the whole system fails. If it's not for the children there and their parents and everything else, it's going to fall apart. So for those people who haven't come to our park, y'all come on down, okay? And I'll be looking for you. But seriously, you will get as much out of it as anybody else, because it's a great place to be. Olmsted had a great idea. His family continued it. I'm really grateful to Franklin Murphy, in spite of some of the other things I just heard, but I'm really grateful to it because he pushed to have this done. It wasn't easy. He had to tell people, you got to get out. Can you imagine somebody knocking, just, excuse me, you got to move. Why? We're building a park. Well, I don't care about the park. Well, we're taking your house. You have to leave. And that's what he did. And he not only did the people who maybe didn't have a lot of money, he did the people with fat pockets. You have to leave. Now that's a fight. And he did it, and he won the fight. He got these people to move because it was better for the rest of the community to have this green space where people could go and recharge, recreate, and have a good time with each other. And that is so important. So I'm going to shut up before I go into my notes, which are in my bag, but I'm going to leave those here for now. But again, I want to thank you all for coming out and be interested in parks. And I hope you take me up on my offer to come and visit the parks, because we need you, and I think you need the park. So it goes both ways. So thank you again.
I think, because we're running along, I appreciate all your comments too, because that's really, the history continues in our parks. Those other slides? Oh, I'm sorry. Nope. Oh, okay. So I just have a bit of an advertisement because of our 125th, so. Looking for stories, home videos, and now we'll have that one in between. Well, here, I'll just finish this. We were having a little trouble getting this to the video. We'll show it in just a second, but here's the rest of my plug. So this will come back up after we show that, and also there's information in the back about that. So. Yes, let's see the video. '28, and with a 1925 camera that was the first available to the public. Was this the whole, oh, is this more than, just the clip. I'd had my assistant get a couple little clips. I don't know. It's a branch. That's it? Yeah, no, okay, look behind there. You can see the music gazebo and the structures that have been renovated with the... There's all the chairs, the seating. So there again, you can see the music stand, and at one point you can see Park Avenue Bridge behind. So I think because that we had some difficulty with it, and it's not just the part that we clipped out. Yeah. Okay. So I think it is available. Well, I don't know. Anyway, yes. I see. Okay. Anyway, I was thrilled to have that, but I'm not expecting everybody would have 1928 home movies, but your stories, your photos, we'd love to have. In 1979, county government changed, and the Essex County Park Commission ceased to exist and became part of Essex County, the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Cultural Affairs.
I'm just going to, at some point, edit in
Well, this is just this. This was just the very beginning. So, yes. So, yeah. Well, this is just the very beginning, and it wasn't until 1970-something, so it's not. I also have a presentation that I've done at some other local libraries and so on. That's the parks in the 1910s, which is the next section, really. But yes, every single one of our parks has a long history from before it was part of the parks to today, and so we certainly want to celebrate all of that in this anniversary year coming up.
Question about the $15 billion budget that you spent to acquire all the land.
Okay.
I
believe it was the acquisition and the development. Right. So I don't know whether that figures were included or whether it was just what the Essex County Park of Commission paid. I'm not certain. But our annual reports every year had the costs for the projects and how much was expended to develop. And one of the problems with having the citizens get legislation for the parks is they might have only gotten enough to acquire the land but not to develop it. And so one example where the commission didn't act on the legislation was what was set aside, was legislated for Verona Park in, I think, 1917. And then World War II or World War I came, and so they postponed it, and then by the time they would have been able to start acquiring the land and have workers to work on developing it, it wasn't sufficient of money. So they had to go back and ask for more at that point. Yes? Okay, let's see, Cherry Blossom Tour. So it was the first eastern terminus of the US airmail, and it would be kind of in the park, as I understand it, where the parking lot at the Cherry Blossom Welcome Center is in the extension. And it was very short-lived there because it was very dangerous. The pilots had to come in and see the Second River and the Tiffany jewelry factory tower and turn there, but at least one of them hit the tower. And then there were some young people, some teenagers who came to see the planes because this is a big thing. And the one kid at least did not understand that when the plane stopped, the propeller did not stop. So there were crashes. It was a very dangerous airfield, and it didn't last long. They had to make a sharp turn there then when they saw the Tiffany. Anyway, it was short-lived that it was an airfield. But there have been other landings of things in people in the parks. We have a photo of, I don't know, some Miss New Jersey or something, and there were some other times that was. But, yes? Oh, yes. So, I think, different slide presentation. So, yes, our Parks Administration Building was built in 1916. Prior to that, there was a frame house that had been a saloon and bar that was used, and with all of these plans from the Olmsted, Bogart and Barrett, Carrere and Hastings, Arthur Dillon, and so on, the park employees and the commission were concerned that a frame building was not the place to have them in. So they set aside, I believe, $100,000 to build that building, and it's all concrete, and it's an Italian Renaissance. It has, so the architect was Harold Van Buren McGonigal, and then his wife also did decorative work, and he had her do some of that. So there's friezes and lots of decorative work and iron grills on the windows with trees for the parks. Anyway, yeah, very interesting building. Well, so the land was purchased, but some people were willing to pay to have it be a park. Some land got donated probably farther north. But often when they purchased a building, sometimes the buildings themselves were moved to another property, and we have an instance where that happened for West Side Park, but then they expanded West Side Park, and so the place that they had put it needed to be moved again. And sometimes then the houses themselves were sold off to someone. So we have one at Watsessing. We have correspondence where the person was asking if he could stay in his house another week to use the closet, so the water closet, and because, I don't know, something about moving his thing. So they were compensated for the property. And I mean, there were more people who were willing to find a price and sell and move than insisted on a condemnation proceedings.